Okey diyoruz, en son ne oldu? King Killer Chronicles dünyasına ait kısa bir hikaye okuduk. 5 madde var. Benim anladığım şu ana kadar King Killer Chronicles dünyasında yayınlanmış olan. O kadar çok sesleri çıkıyor. Derdiniz de sizin ya. Hiç böyle olmuyor normalde ha. Kafayı yediler bugün ya. Şunları bir bakıp geliyorum. Hani bir abartmıyorum. 1 saat 2 saat arası zamandır böyleler. Bugün bir şey var. Bir şey seziyorlar ama neyi seziyorlar acaba? Yani bir büyük bir olay mı oluyor bunların arasında falan bilmiyorum. Böyle bir turnuva falan. Bakalım. Neyse 5 madde var. İlk 2 tanesi zaten klasik iki kitabımız. Rüzgarın Adı, Bilgi Adamı, Korkusu, onları okuduk. Bir tane hikaye okuduk, o da işte bir sürü fantezi edebiyatı yazarından birer tane hikaye istemiş adamın biri ya da kadının biri, bilmiyorum. Bunların alayını toplayıp bir kitap çıkarmış. Oradaki bir hikayeydi. Onun özetini yapacağım şimdi. Onun dışında 2 hikaye daha var. Bir tanesi bu okuyacağımız 176 sayfalık ufak kitapçık. Diğeri de adı, Türkçesi neydi onun da? Silent Regard of Things. İngilizcesi, Türkçesi ne anlama geliyor onu da bilmiyorum bu arada. Sessizliğin boku bir şeydi. Çevirisi de tam çevirisi de olmaması lazım ama Türkçesinin ne olduğunu ben kendim de bilmiyorum. Neyse onu okuduydum önceden. Bunu hiç okumadım. Bunu ilk defa siz de okuyacağım. Bundan sonra okuyacağımızı ben önceden okuduydum. Başka da bir şey yok. Benim bildiğim sanki hani bir iki tane daha hikaye varmış gibi bir his böyle içimde ama yazdım Google'a işte böyle böyle King Killer Chronicles okuma sırası falan, bir şey çıkmadı başka diyor. Bundan önceki videoda okuduğumuz hikayede bir tane ağacın hikayesini okuduk. Bu ağaç işte bir tane kulenin yanında, bu kulede bir tane kadın yaşıyor. Sonra bir tane erkek bu kadınla beraber zaman geçirmeye başlıyor. Bunların sevgili olduğunu tahmin ediyoruz ama ağacın bakış açısından gördüğümüz için ağaç bir şeylere sadece iyi kötü gözüyle bakıyor. Yaşı ilerledikçe güzel ve çirkin olarak da bakmaya başlıyor ama bu kadar hani, kesinlikle işte evlilik, arkadaşlık, aile no fucking way diyor. Çok enteresan bir deneyimdi çünkü hani bir şekilde hayvanların, bitkilerin bu dünyayı öyle gördüğünü anlıyorsunuz gibi bir his geliyordu. Bence hikaye okurken tam öyle bir his geldi. Adem, evet, bir kuş için de hayat böyle. Ya iyi ya kötü. Bunlar da öyle işte. Bugün acaba bunları iyi olan ne ki de 2 saat boyunca aralıksız hepsi bir arada uçuşup bağırışıp duruyorlar. Normalde yapmıyorlar çünkü böyle bir şey var. Böyle bir etkinlik gibi bir şey yapıyorlar bence. Neyse hani hayvanlar ve bitkiler, insan olmayan canlılar dünyayı iyi ve kötü üstünden görüyor çok net bir şekilde. Yemek yiyor ona iyi geldiği için, kavga ediyor ona iyi geldiği için, dayak yemek ona kötü geliyor, üzülüyor falan. Öyle hani, öyle bir bakış açısı üstünden bak ya.
What the hell be?
O kadar çoklar ve o kadar çok ses yapıyorlar ki hani rahatsız olmaktan değil, bir değişik yani, ne oluyor şu an? Neyse tamam, artık buna çok odaklandım, bunu unutuyor. Hani o tekillik mi denir, o basitlik mi denir? Onun içine girip çok kompleks şeyleri insan gibi onun filtresiyle görmek falan aşırı enteresan. Hani böyle kafam geldi falan oldu hikaye okurken. Benim kafam güzelken hikayeyi birisi bana okusaydı çok sarardı. Ya da ben kafam güzelken hikaye okusaydım da çok sarardı falan. Bunları düşündüm. Öyle. Sonra işte bu erkekle beraber kadın gidiyor bir ara. Sonra kadın tek başına geri dönüyor. Ağlıyor falan. Ağaç bize anlatıyor bunları. Biz işte orada anlıyoruz. Ayrıldılar yüksek ihtimal. Sonra işte kadın ağacı bir şekilde çok seviyor. Ağaçlar arasında bir bağ oluyor. Hani ağacın altında kalıyor. Ağaca şarkı söylüyor musun falan. Kadının bir büyücü olduğuna dair detaylar bize verilmeye başlıyor. En başta emin olamıyoruz. Zaten en azından ben olamadım ama sonlara doğru netleşiyor iyice. Hatta kadın direkt ağacın adını falan söyleyebilmeye başlıyor. Ağaç insana falan dönüşüyor ya da ağaç eğiliyor, bükülüyor, bir şeyler yapıyor falan. Kadın şarkı söylüyor diyor ağaç ama kadın aslında ağacın adını söylüyor orada. Kadın büyü yapıyor diyoruz. Sonra bir gün kurt sürüsü, insan sürüsü ve gölgeli birisi geliyor. O mu bir şehir miydi lan, yoksa şehirlerden bir tane? Evet lan, o 7 tane şehrin 7'sine de Halyaks bok püsür saldırıyordu. O şehirlerden bir tanesi de buydu. Bu kadının tek başına yaşadığı yerdi. Ama yanlış bir detay var. O gölgeli yaratığın Halyaks ya da Enkanis ya da bok püsür olduğunu biliyoruz. Enkanis değil sanırım, Halyaks. Ve ağaç onu öldürüyor. Halyaks Charlie ölebileceğini biliyoruz. Geri dönüyor öldükten sonra. Sanırım öyle bir şey oluyor ama yine de enteresan bir nokta. Hani bir iki günlüğüne bile öldürülebilmesi büyük bir olay benim anladığım. Neyse ağaç Hali Aksu öldürüyor. Sonra kadın diyor ki ağaca benim gitmem lazım ama beni bekle geri döneceğim. Ha, ağaç işte en baş şey diyor ben de seninle beraber gelmek istiyorum. Kadın diyor ki hayır sen buralara bak buralara bekçilik et. Ağaç da tamam diyor kadın sonra gidiyor ağaç bekliyor bekliyor bekliyor bekliyor. Kadın hiçbir zaman gelmeyeceğini biz anlıyoruz ama ağaç anlamıyor. O kadar güzeldi ki oraları falan. Çok aşırı enteresan ve güzel bir hikayeydi kesinlikle. Burada da bir ağaç görüyoruz falan. Hoşuma gitti. Key diyoruz. Durum bu. Başka diyecek bir şey var mı? Düşünüp geliyorum. Okay, The Lightning Tree. The Bast. Bast'ın hikayesi gibi bir şey okuyacağız zaten ama başka hiçbir şey bilmiyorum. Neredeyse Patrick Rothfuss dedik sanırım. Bir şahsi diyoruz. The Lightning Tree, Patrick Rothfuss, Morning the Narrow Road. Bast almost made it out the back door of the Waystone Inn. He actually had made it outside. Both feet were over the threshold and the door was almost entirely eased shut behind him before he heard his master's voice. Bast paused, hand on the ledge. He frowned at the door, hardly a hand's span from being closed. He hadn't made any noise. He knew it. He was familiar with all the silent pieces of the inn, which floorboards hide beneath the food, which windows tuck. Yani buradaki detay bir şekilde Claude'la evin bir bütün olduğunu, aynı şey, aynı kişi olduklarını konuştuyduk sanki. Evin kendisi olduğu için ne kadar sessiz olursa olsun yine de anlayabiliyor desek biraz boş bir açıklamaymış gibi geldi bana ama olsun okey. The back door's hinges creaked sometimes, depending on their mood. But that was easy to work around. Was shifted his grip on the ledge, lifted up so that the door's weight didn't hang so heavy. Then eased it slowly closed. No creak. The swinging door was softer than a sigh. Was stood upright and grinned. His face was sweet and sly and wild. He looked like a naughty child who had managed to steal the moon and eat it. Benzetmeye gidiyor. His smile was like the last sliver of remaining moon, sharp and white and dangerous. Bast, the call came again, louder this time. Nothing so crass as a shoot. His master will never stoop to the loving. But when he wanted to be heard, his baritone will not be stopped by anything so insubstantial as an oaken door. His voice carried like a horn, and Bas felt his name tug at him like a hand around his heart. Bas felt his name tug at him like a hand around his heart. Bir şekilde yine kvotluğunu kullanıyor bir seviyeye kadar. Okey diyoruz. Bas sighed, then opened the door lightly and strode back inside. He was dark and tall and lovely. When he walked, he looked like he was dancing. Yes, Reshi, he called. After a moment, the innkeeper stepped into the kitchen. He wore a clean white apron and his hair was red. Other than that, he was painfully unremarkable. His face held a dofy placidness of bored innkeepers everywhere. Despite the early hour, he looked tired. He handed Basley a leather book. We almost forgot this Centurion Tentiture neydiyse o kitabın adı. He said without a hint of sarcasm. Bast took the book and made a show of looking surprised. Oh, thank you, Rishi. Binky was shrugged and his mouth made the shape of a smile. No bother, Bast. While you're out on your errands, would you mind picking up some eggs? Bast nodded, tucking the book under his arm. Anything else? He asked dutifully. Maybe some carrots too. I'm thinking we'll do stew tonight. It's failing, so we'll need to be ready for a crowd. His mouth turned up slightly at one corner as he said this. Then keeper started to turn away, then stopped. Oh, the Williams boy stopped by last night looking for you. Didn't leave any sort of message. He raised an eyebrow at Bast. The look said more than it said. Okey, yukarıda bir yerde demiştik ki bu innkeeper'ların hepsinin ortak bir suratından olduğundan bahsetmişti. Daha hiçbir şekilde kvot demedi ve yine de innkeeper falan yapıyor. Şu an kot. Benim anladığım tam kot. True and true kot şu an. Ne zaman oluyor bu olaylar bilmiyorum. Hani sanırım Wise Man's Fear'dan sonra değil. Çünkü o sıra olsaydı millet kesinlikle ayrıntılı ayrıntılı bunun hakkında konuşurmuş gibi geliyor bu kitap hakkında, ama böyle silik bir kitap. Çok okumasak da oluyor. Tarzında insanların yaklaştığı bir kitap benim anladığım, hissettiğim bu açıdan sanırım çok da şey değil. Güncel değil. Şu an olayların tarihi değil. Okay. I haven't the slightest idea what he wants, but said. The innkeeper made an uncomfortable noise and turned back toward the common room. Before he'd taken three steps, Buzz was already out the door and running through the early morning sunlight. By the time Buzz arrived, there were already two children waiting. They played on the huge gray stone that lay half fallen at the bottom of the hill, climbing up the tilting side of it, then jumping down into the tall grass. Knowing they were watching, Buzz took his time climbing the tiny hill. At the top stood what the children called the lightning tree, though these days it was little more than a branchless trunk, barely taller than a man. All the bark had long since fallen away, and the sun had bleached the wood as white as bone, all except the very top, where even after all these years the wood was charred and Jack Black. Buzz touched the trunk with his fingertips and made a slow circuit of the tree. He went diesel the same direction as the turning sun, the proper way for making. Then he turned and switched hands, making three slow circles with his shins. Enteresan kelimeler görüyoruz. Şunu sanırım terimsel bir şey. Bu Faye için. With his shins, bu da öyle. Hiç bilmiyorum. The turning was against the world. It was the way of breaking. Back and forth he went, as if the tree were a bobbin and he was winding and unwinding. Finally he sat with his back against the tree and set the book on a nearby stone. The sun shone on the gold gilt letters, Selim Tincture. Then he amused himself by tossing stones into the nearby stream that cut into the low slope of the hill opposite the graystone. Okay, bir tane graystone'a yakınlar. Böyle bir detay var mıydı? Biz biliyor muyduk? Sanki bilmiyorduk. Waystone ine yakın bir graystone var. Okay. After a minute, a round little blond boy trudged up the hill. He was the baker's youngest son, Bran. He smelled of sweat and fresh bread and something else, something out of place. Kesin demir falan diyoruz. The boy's slow approach had an air of ritual about it. He crested a small hill and stood there for a moment quietly, the only noise coming from the other two children playing below. Finally, Buzz turned to look the boy over. He was no more than 8 or 9, well-dressed and plumper than most of the other town's children. He carried a wad of white cloth in his hand. The boy swallowed nervously. I need a lie. Kesinlikle böyle bir cümleye başlama aklıma gelmedi şu ana kadar. Very fucking good diyoruz. But nodded, but sort of lie. The boy gingerly opened his hand, revealing the wad of cloth to be a makeshift bandage spattered with bright red. It stuck to his hand slightly. Buzz nodded. That was what he'd smelled before. I was playing with my mom's knives, Bran said. Buzz examining the cut. It ran shallow along the meat near the tongue. Nothing serious, hurt much. Nothing like the birching I'll get if she finds out I was messing with her knives. Buzz nodded sympathetically. You cleaned the knife and put it back, Bran nodded. Buzz tapped his lips thoughtfully. You thought you saw a big black rat It scared you. You even knife didn't cut yourself. Yesterday one of the other children told you a story about rats chewing off soldiers' ears and toes while they slept. It gave you nightmares. Bran gave a shudder. Who told me the story? A shark picked someone you don't like. The boy grinned viciously. Tam ağır iyi. Must begin to tick off things on his fingers. Get some blood on the knife before you throw it. He pointed at the cloth the boy had wrapped his hand in. Get rid of that too. The blood is dry, obviously old. Can you work up a good cry? The boy shook his head, seeming a little embarrassed by the fact. Put some salt in your eyes. Get all snotty and teary before you run to them. Hole and blubber. And when they're asking you about your hand, tell your mom you're sorry if you broke her knife. Bran listened, nodding slowly at first, and faster he smiled. That's good. He looked at her nervously. What do I owe you? Any secrets must ask. Çok iyi değil mi? The baker's boy thought for a minute. Old Lance topping the widow creel, he said hopefully. Bas waved his hand for years, everyone knows. Bas rubbed his nose and said, can you bring me two sweet buns later today? Bran nodded, that's a good start, Bas said. What have you got in your pockets? I ain't, diyor. Okay. The boy dug around and held up both his hands. He had two iron shims, a flat greenish stone, a bird's skull, a tangle of string, and a bit of chalk. Bas claimed the string. Then, careful not to touch the shims, he took the greenish stone between two fingers and arched an eyebrow at the boy. After a moment's hesitation, the boy nodded. Bas put the stone in his pocket. But if I get a birching anyway, Brad asked. Bas shrugged. That's your business. You wanted a lie. I gave you a good one. If you want me to get you out of trouble, that's something else entirely. The baker's boy looked disappointed, but he nodded and headed down the hill. Next up the hill was a slightly older boy in tattered homespun. One of the elder boys, Cahill. He had a split lip and a cross of blood around one nostril. He was as furious as only a boy of 10 can be. His expression was a thunderstorm. I caught my brother kissing Greta behind old mill, he said as soon as he crested the hill, not waiting for Bas to ask. He knew I was sweet on her. Bas spread his hands helplessly, shrugging. Revenge, the boy spat. Public revenge, Bas asked, or secret revenge? The boy touched his split lip with his tongue. Secret revenge, he said in a low voice. How much revenge, Bas asked. The boy thought for a bit. O kadar çocuk bir kitap ki şoklardayım şu an. Then held up his hands about 2 feet apart. This much. Şöyle mi ediyor? Okay. Bassett, how much on a scale from mouse to bowl? The boy rubbed his nose for a while. About a cat's word, he said. Maybe a dog's word. Not like Crazy Martin's dog, though. Like the Bentons' dogs. Bass nodded and tilted his head back in a thoughtful way. Okay, he said, pissing his shoes. The boy looked skeptical. That don't sound like a whole dog's word of revenge. Bas shook his head. We piss in a cup and hide it. Let it sit for a day or two. Then one night when he's put his shoes by the fire, pour the piss on his shoes. Don't make a puddle, just get them damp. In the morning they'll be dry and probably won't even smell too much. What's the point? The boy interrupted angrily. That's not a fleas word of revenge. Bas held up a pacifying hand. When his feet get sweaty, he start to smell like piss. Bas said calmly, if he steps in a puddle, he smell like piss. When he walks in the snow, he smell like piss. It will be hard for him to figure out exactly where it's coming from, but everyone will know your brother is the one that reeks. Buzz grinned at the boy. I'm guessing your Greta isn't going to want to kiss the boy who can't stop pissing himself. Admiration spread across the young boy's face like sunrise in the mountains. That's the most bastardly thing I've ever heard, he said. Ev strike. O kadar çocuk gibi ki. Amına koyayım ya. Buzz tried to look modest and failed. Have you got anything for me? I found a white beehive, the boy said. That will do for a start, Buzz said. Where? It's off past the horizons, past Little Creek. The boy squatted and drew a map in the dirt, you see. Buzz nodded anything else. Well, I know where Crazy Martin keeps his still. Buzz raised his eyebrows at that, really? The boy drew another map and gave some directions. Then he stood and dusted off his knees, we square. Buzz cut his foot in the dirt, destroying the map, we square. The boy dusted off his knees. I got a message too. Reich wants to see you. Buzz, sen neymişsin lan? O aşırı iyi ya. Bak hey diyoruz. Buzz shook his head firmly. He knows the rules. Tell him no. I already told him, the boy said with a comically exaggerated shrug. But I'll tell him again if I see him. There were no more children waiting after Cale. So Buzz tucked the leather book under his arm and went on a long, rambling stroll. He found some wild raspberries and ate them. He took a drink from the ostler's well. Eventually, Buzz climbed to the top of a nearby bluff where he gave a great stretch before tucking the leather-bound copy of Serum Tincture into a spreading hawthorn tree where a white branch made a cozy nook against the trunk. He looked up at the sky then, clear and bright, no clouds, not much wind, warm but not hot. Hadn't rained for a solid span. It wasn't a market day, hours before noon on Philly. Buzz's brow furrowed a bit, as if performing some complex calculation. Then he nodded to himself. Then Buzz headed back down the bluff, past old Lance Place and around the brambles that bordered the Allard farm. When he came to Little Creek, he cut some reeds and idly whittled at them with a small bright knife. Then brought the string out of his pocket and bound them together, fashioning a tidy set of shepherd's pipes. He blew across the top of them and cocked his head to listen to their sweet discord. His bright knife trimmed some more, and he blew again. This time the tune was closer, which made the discord far more grating. Bast's knife flicked again, once, twice, thrice. Then he put it away and brought the pipes closer to his face. He breathed in through his nose, smelling the wet green of them. Then he licked the fresh-cut tops of the reeds, the flicker of his tongue a sudden, startling red. Then he drew a breath and blew against the pipes. This time the sun was bright as moonlight, lively as a leaping fish, sweet as stolen fruit. Smiling, Buzz headed off into the Bentons' back hills, and it wasn't long before he heard the low, mindless bleat of distant sheep. A minute later, Buzz came over the crest of a hill and saw 2 dozen fat, daft sheep cropping grass in the green valley below. It was shadowy here and secluded. The lack of recent rain meant the grazing was better here. The steep sides of the valley meant the sheep weren't prone to straying and didn't need much looking after. A young woman sat in the shade of a spreading elm that overlooked the valley. She had taken off her shoes and bonnet. Her long thick hair was the color of ripe wheat. was began playing then a dangerous tune. It was sweet and bright and slow and sly. The shepherdess perked up at the sound of it, or so it seemed at first. She lifted her head, excited, but no, she didn't look in his direction at all. She was merely climbing to her feet to have a stretch, rising high up onto her toes, hands twining over her head. Still apparently unaware she was being serenaded, the young woman picked up a nearby blanket, spread it beneath the tree, and sat back down. It was a little odd, as she'd been sitting there before without the blanket. Perhaps she'd just grown chilly. Bast continued to play as he walked down the slope of the valley toward her. He did not hurry, and the music he made was sweet and playful and languorous all at once. The shepherdess showed no sign of noticing the music or Bast himself. In fact, she looked away from him toward the far end of the little valley, as if curious what the sheep might be doing there. When she turned her head, it exposed the lovely line of her neck from her perfect shell-like ear down to the gentle swell of breast that showed above her bodice. Eyes intent on the young woman, but stepped on a loose stone and stumbled awkwardly down the hill. He blew one hard, squawking note, then dropped a few more from his song as he threw out one arm wildly to catch his balance. The shepherdess laughed then, but she was pointedly looking at the other end of the valley. Perhaps the sheep had done something humorous. Yes, that was surely it. They could be funny animals at times. Even so, one can only look at sheep for so long. She sighed and relaxed, leaning back against the sloping trunk of the tree. The motion accidentally pulled the hem of her skirt up slightly past her knee. Her calves were round and tan and covered with the lightest down of honey-colored hair. Bast continued down the hill, his steps delicate and graceful. He looked like a stalking cat. He looked like he were dancing. Apparently satisfied, the sheep were safe. The shepherdess sighed again, closed her eyes, and lay her head against the trunk of the tree. Her face tightened up to catch the sun. She seemed about to sleep, but for all her sighing, her breath seemed to be coming rather quickly. And when she shifted restlessly to make herself more comfortable, one hand fell in such a way that it accidentally dripped the hem of her dress even farther up until it showed a pale expanse of thigh. It is hard to grin while playing shepherd's pipes. Somehow, Bast managed it. The sun was climbing the sky when Bast returned to the lightning tree, pleasantly sweaty and in a state of mind disheveled. There were no children waiting near the gravestones this time, which suited him perfectly. He did a quick circle of the tree again when he reached the top of the hill, once in each direction to ensure his small workings were still in place. Then he slumped down and at the foot of the tree and leaned against the trunk. Less than a minute later, his eyes were closed and he was snoring slightly. After the better part of an hour, the near silent sound of footsteps roused him. He gave a great stretch and spied a thin boy with freckles and clothes that were slightly past the point where they might merely be called well-worn. "Post-trill," Bast said happily. "How's the road to Tinia?" "Seems sunny enough to me today," the boy said as he came to the top of the hill. "And I found a lovely secret by the roadside. Something I thought you might be interested in." "Ah," Bast said, "come have a seat then. What sort of secret did you stumble on?" Puzzle set crossed leg on the grass nearby. I know where Amberly takes her bath. Bust raised a half-interested eyebrow. Is that so? Cosford grinned. You faker. Don't pretend you don't care. Of course I care, Bust said. She's the sixth prettiest girl in town after all. Sixth, the boy said indignant. She's the second prettiest and you know it. Perhaps fourth, Bust conceded after Ania. Anya's legs are skinny as a chicken's, Kosra observed calmly. Bast smiled at the boy. To each his own, but yes, I am interested. What would you like in trade? An answer, a favor, a secret? I want a favor and information, the boy said with a small smirk. His dark eyes were sharp in his lean face. I want good answers to three questions, and it's worth it. And it's worth it because Amberlee is the third prettiest girl in town. Uşak felaketi. Bast opened his mouth as if he were going to protest and shrugged and smiled. No favor, but I'll give you three answers on a subject named beforehand. He countered. Any subject except that of my employer, whose trust in me I cannot in good conscience betray. Kosrin nodded in agreement. Three full answers, he said, with no equivocating or bullshittery. But nodded, so long as the questions are focused and specific. No, tell me everything you know about nonsense. That wouldn't be a question, Kosrin pointed out. Exactly, Bas said. And you agree not to tell anyone else where Amberlee is having her bullshittery Kosrin. Ha bir dakika. Amberlee is having her bullshittery. Burada bir nokta olacak. Üzüldüm şu an. Çok güzel okuyorduk. Yazım hatası yakışmıyor. Kosra scolded and bastled. You little cocker. You would have sold it 20 times, wouldn't you? The boy shrugged easily, not denying it and not embarrassed either. It's valuable information. Was chuckled. Three full, earnest answers on a single subject with the understanding that I am the only one you taught. You are, the boy said solemnly. I came here first, and with the understanding that you won't tell Amberlee anyone knows. Kosser looked so offended at this that Bas didn't bother waiting for him to agree, and with the understanding that you won't show up yourself. The dark-eyed boy sped a couple of words that surprised Bas more than his earlier use of equivocating. Fine, Kosser growled. But if you don't know the answer to my question, I get to ask another. Bas thought about it for a moment, then nodded. And if I pick a subject you don't know much about, I get to choose another. Okay, sadece belirtmek istediğim kitap şu ana kadar harika gidiyor. Böyle devam ederse felaket saracak okuması. Very fucking good. Another note, that's fair. And you loan me another book, the boy said, his dark eyes glaring, and a copper penny. And you have to describe her breasts to me. Bastri begged his head and laughed, done. They shook on the deal. The boy's thin hand was delicate as a bird's wing. O kadar güzel bir kitap ki bu okuyayım. Bas lean against the lightning tree, yawning and rubbing the back of his neck. So, what's your subject? Kosra's grim look lifted a little then, and he grinned excitedly. I want to know about the Fae. It says a great deal that Bast finished this great yob of a yawn as if nothing were the matter. It is quite hard to yawn and stretch when your belly feels like you swallowed a lump of bitter iron and your mouth has gone suddenly dry. But Bast was something of a professional dissembler, so he yawned and stretched, and even went so far as to scratch himself under one arm lazily. Well, the boy asked impatiently, do you know enough about them? A fair amount, Bast said, doing a much better job of modest this time. More than most folk I imagine. Cosrill leaned forward, his thin face intent. I thought you might. You aren't from around here, you know things. You've seen what's really out there in the world. Some of it was admitted. He looked up at the sun. Ask your questions then. I have to be somewhere come noon. The boy nodded seriously, then looked down at the grass in front of himself for a moment, thinking, what are they like? Bast blinked for a moment, taken aback. Then he laughed helplessly and threw up his hands. Merciful Tehlü, do you have any idea how crazy that question is? They're not like anything, they're like themselves. Cosrill looked indignant. Don't you try to shim me, he said, leveling a finger at Bast. I said no bullshittery. I am not, honest I'm not. Bast raised his hands defensively. It's just an impossible question to answer is all. What would you say if I asked you what people were like? How could you answer that? There are so many kinds of people and they're all different. So it's a big question, Cosrill said. Give me a big answer. Şu an Kostril yanılıyor ama her ne kadar tatlış bir uşak olsa bile okay diyoruz. It's not just big, Buzz said. It would fill a book. The boy gave a profound and sympathetic shrug. Buzz called, it could be argued that your question is neither focused nor specific. Kostril raised an eyebrow. So we're arguing now. I thought we were trading information fully and freely. If you asked me where Amber Lee was going for her bath, and I said in a stream, it would feel like I'd measured you some pretty short corn, wouldn't you? But sighed, fair enough. But if I told you every rumor and snippet I'd ever heard, this would take a span of days. Most of it would be useless. And some probably wouldn't even be true because it's just from stories that I've heard. Cosrill frowned, but before he could protest, Buzz held up a hand. Here is what I'll do. Despite the unfocused nature of your question, I give you an answer that covers the rough shape of things, and Buzz hesitated. One true secret on the subject, okay? Two secrets, Kostra said, his dark eyes glittering with excitement. Excitement. Fair enough, Bas took a deep breath. When you say fey, you're talking about anything that lives in the fey. That includes a lot of things that are just creatures, like animals. Here you have dogs and squirrels and bears. In the fey, they have roan and dannerlings and tro, Bas nodded, and tro, the real. And dragons, but shook his head, not that I ever heard, not anymore. Kostril looked disappointed. What about the fairy folk, like fairy tinkers and such? The boy narrowed his eyes. Mind you, this isn't a new question, merely an attempt to focus your ongoing answer. Maslow helplessly. Lord and lady, ongoing. Was your mother scared by an Ezai when she was pregnant? Where do you get that kind of talk? I stay awake in church, Cosrill shrugged, and sometimes Abbe Liudin lets me read his books. What do they look like? Like regular people, Bas said. Like you and me, the boy asked. Bas fought back a smile. Just like you or me. You wouldn't hardly notice if they passed you on the street, but there are others. Some of them are, they're different, more powerful. Like Varsa never dead, some Bas conceded, but some are powerful in other ways. Like the mayor is powerful. Like the mayor is powerful, or like a moneylender. Bast's expression went sour. Many of those, they're not good to be around. They'd like They like to trick people, play with them, hurt them. So the examine blood out of costume that this, they sound like demons. But hesitated, then nodded a reluctant agreement. Some are very much like demons, he admitted. Or so close as it makes no difference. Are some of them like angels too? The boy asked. It's nice to think that, but said, I hope so. Where do they come from? Buzz cocked his head. That's your second question, then, he asked. I'm guessing it must be, as it's got nothing to do with what the Fae are like. Kostril grimaced, seeming a little embarrassed, though Buzz couldn't tell if he was ashamed he'd gotten carried away with his questions or ashamed he'd been caught trying to get a free answer. Sorry, he said, is it true that a fairy can never lie? Some can't, Buzz said. Some don't like to. Bir dakika, kıtayı söylemeyecek. Some don't like to, aynen. Some are happy to lie, but would never go back on promise or break their word. He shrugged. Others lied quite well, and do so at every opportunity. Kosu began to ask something. Yes, Buzz, clear this throat. You have to admit, he said, that's a pretty good answer. I even gave you a few free questions to have with the focus of things as it were. Kosu gave a slightly sullen nod. Here is your first secret, Buzz held up a single finger. Most of the Fae don't come to this world. They don't like it. It rubs all rough against them, like wearing a burlap shirt. But when they do come, they like some places better than others. They like wild places, secret places, strange places. There are many types of Fae, many courts and houses. And all of them are ruled according to their own desires. Buzz continued in a tone of soft conspiracy, but something that appeals to all the Fae are places with connections to the raw, true things that shape the world. Places that are touched with fire and stone. Places that are close to water and air. When all four came to get come together. Buzz paused to see if the boy would interject something here. But Kostru's face had lost the sharp cunning it had had before. He looked like a child again, not slightly agape, his eyes wide with wonder. Second secret, Buzz said, the Fae folk look nearly like we do, but not exactly. Most has something about them that makes them different, their eyes. The eyes, oğlum Fae damına koyayım, Fae işte, Fae diyoruz. Belki de kendi anasının babasının çocuğu bile değil doğru düzgün. Anası reckless, anası normal insan. Babası zaten normal insan. Değil mi diyoruz? Oğlum Kvot kimin çocuğu lan? Reckless, luckless, şansı olmayan Ajax onun torunu değilse bir şey bilmiyorum. Bir şahsi diyor. Heyecanlandım. Their ears, the color of their hair or skin. Sometimes they're taller than normal or shorter or stronger or more beautiful. Yine Kvot diyoruz. Like Felurian. Yes, Buzz said testily. Like Felurian. But any of the Fae who has the skill to travel here will have craft enough. Yes. To hide those things, he leaned back, nodding to himself. This is a type of magic all the fair folk share. Are you a fae diye soracak gibi hissettim bir şahsi diyor. But threw the final command out like a fisherman casting a lure. Kostra closed his mouth and swallowed hard. He didn't fight the line. Didn't even know that he'd been hooked. What sort of magic can they do? Buzz rolled his eyes emphatically, Oh, come now. There's another whole book's worth of question. Well, maybe you should just write a book, Cosmo said flatly. Then you can lend it to me and kill two birds with one stone. The comment seemed to catch Buzz off his stride. Write a book. That's what people do when they know every damn thing, isn't it? Cosmo said sarcastically. They write it down so they can show off. Buzz looked thoughtful for a moment, then shook his head as if to clear it. Okay, here's the bones of what I know. They don't think of it as magic. They never use that term. They talk of art or craft. They talk of seeming or shapy. He looked up at the sun and pursed his lips. But if they were being frank, and they are rarely frank, mind you, they will tell you almost everything they do is either glamourai or grammarai. Glamourai is the art of making something seem. Grammarai is the craft of making something be. Buzz rushed ahead before the boy could interrupt. Glamourai is easier. They can make a thing seem other than it is. They could make a white shirt seem like it was blue, or a torn shirt seem like it was whole. Most of the folk have at least a scrap of this art, enough to hide themselves from mortal eyes. If their hair was all of silver white, their glamourai could make it look as black as night. Kostra's face was lost in wonder yet again. Bu böyle diyor da ben şu an lost in wonder'ım ve ben çocuk olsaydım eğer bunları dinlerken öyle bir coğrafyada yaşayan falan benim ağzımın salyaları, sümükleri üstümde birikecek kadar çok akmış olurdu o zamana kadar zaten. Ben de öyle de oluyor bu arada. Bazen çok dikkatli dinlersem ağzımdan salya falan akıyor böyle. Kontrolü kaybediyorum. Çocukken çok daha fazlaydı. Şu an kontrol ediyorum kendimi. Öyle yani. Yeah, which I know. But it was not the gormless, gaping wonder of before. It was a thoughtful wonder. A clever wonder. Benimki böyle ekstradan clever falan değil. Daha demin dediğim başka bir şey hakkında konuşmaya başladı şimdi. Curious and hungry. It was the sort of wonder that would steer a boy toward a question that started with a how. Buzz could see the shape of these things moving in the boy's dark eyes. His damn clever eyes, too clever by half. Soon those vague wonderings would start to crystallize into questions like, how do they make their glamourai, or even worse, how might a young boy break it? And what then, with a question like that hanging in the air? Nothing good would come of it. To break a promise fairly made and lie outright was retrograde to his desire. Even worse to do it in this place. Far easier to tell the truth and make sure something happened to the boy. But honestly, he liked the boy. He wasn't dull or easy. He wasn't mean or low. He pushed back. He was funny and grim and hungry and more alive than any three other people in the town all put together. He was bright as broken glass and sharp enough to cut himself, and was too, apparently. Buzz rubbed his face. This never used to happen. He had never been in conflict with his own desire before he came here. He hated it. It was so simply singular before. Want and have, tam da bunu konuştuk önceki hikaye hakkında. See and take, run and chase, thirst and slake. And if he were thwarted in pursuit of his desire, what of it? That was simply the way of things. The desire itself was still his, it was still pure. It wasn't like that now. Now his desires grew complicated. They constantly conflicted with each other. İşte bizi insan yapan, değerli yapan bu diyoruz. Bro, o kadar çok böyle complication var ki işin içinde. O kadar derinleşebiliyoruz ki dini keşfedebiliyoruz. O derece derinleşiyoruz diyoruz. Cool. Ama buradaki dini yanlış diyormuşum gibi hissettim. Videoyu dinlerken bir kere daha düşüneceğim bunu. He felt endlessly turned against himself. Nothing was simple anymore. He was pulled so many ways. Bazı Kostya said, his head cocked to the side, concern plain on his face. Are you okay? He asked. What's the matter? Was smiling on the smile. He was a curious boy, of course. That was the way. That was the narrow road between desires. I was just thinking. Grammar is much harder to explain. I can't say I understand it all that well myself. Just do your best, Kostya said kindly. Whatever you tell me will be more than I know. No, he couldn't kill this boy. That will be too hard a thing. Grammar is changing a thing, Bas said, making an inarticulate gesture, making it into something different than what it is. Like turning lead into gold, Kostya asked. Is that how they make fairy gold? Bas made a point of smiling at the question. Good guess, but that's glamour. It's easy, but it doesn't last. That's why people who take fairy gold end up with pockets full of stones or acorns in the morning. Could they turn gravel into gold? Kostya asked, if they really wanted to. It's not that sort of change, Bas said, though he still smiled and nodded at the question. This to be, grammar is about shifting. It's about making something into more of what it already is. Kostya's face twisted with confusion. Bas took a deep breath and let it out through his nose. Let me try something else. What have you got in your pockets? Tamam, bitmesini bekledim. Oha, o kadar büyük bir ses ki 3, 2 farklı şekilde daha yankılandı. İlk kendisiydi, ikincisi de ilk yankısı, üçüncüsü de ikinci yankısı oldu. What the hell diyoruz. Kostya rummaged about and held out his hands. There was a brass button, a scrap of paper, a stub of pencil, a small folding knife, and a stone with a hole in it, of course. O ne demek? Bir taşın içinde delik var. Sapan olarak falan yok. What the hell diyoruz. Bast slowly passed his hand over the collection of oddments, eventually stopping above the knife. It wasn't particularly fine or fancy. It's a piece of smooth wood the size of a finger with a groove where a short hinged blade was tucked away. Bas picked it up delicately between two fingers and set it down on the ground between them. What's this? Kostya stuffed the rest of his belongings into his pocket. It's my knife. That's it, Bas asked. The boy's eyes narrowed suspiciously. What else could it be? Bas brought out his own knife. It was a little larger, and instead of wood, it was carved from a piece of antler, polished and beautiful. Bas opened it, and a bright blade shone in the sun. He laid his knife next to the boy's. Would you trade your knife for mine? Kostya eyed the knife jealously. But even so, there wasn't a hint of hesitation before he shook his head. Why not? Because it's mine, the boy said, his face clouding over. Mine's better, but said matter-of-factly. Kostya reached out and picked up his knife, closing his hand around it possessively. His face was sullen as a stone. My dad gave me this, he said, before he took the king's coin and went to be a soldier and save us from the rebels. He looked up at Bast, as if daring him to say a single word contrary to that. Bast didn't look away from him, just nodded seriously. So it's more than just a knife, he said. It's special to you. Still clutching the knife, Kostya nodded, blinking rapidly. For you, it's the best knife, another nod. It's more important than other knives. And that's not just a seeming, but said, it's something that I is. was a flicker of understanding in Kostya's eyes, but not the scrambled eye. Now imagine if someone could take a knife and make it be more of what a knife is. Make it into the best knife, not just for them, but for anyone. Was picked up his own knife and closed it. If they were really skilled, they could do it with something other than a knife. They could make a fire that was more of what a fire is, hungrier, hotter. Someone truly powerful could do even more. They could take a shadow, hit it off gently, leaving an open space in the empty air. Okay, bu shadow lafı, bundan önceki okuduğumuz hikayedeki shadow falan bir şekilde shadow olayı temelde. Bir şeyin temelinde shadow var. Shadow en önemli 2-3 nesneden, görüntüden bok püsür bir tanesi. Hani hep oraları böyle bir dokundurmama tam açıklamama, dokundurmama tam açıklamama var. Üçüncü kitapta netleşmesine ihtiyacımız olduğu en büyük konulardan bir tanesi bu shadow muhabbetin tam olarak ne olması desem sanırım doğru demiş oluyor. Okay. Kostya drew a breath and leapt to fill it with a question. Like, Valerian said, is that what she did to make Quoth's shadow clock? But not seriously, glad for the question. Hating that it had to be that question. It seems likely to me. What does a shadow do? It conceals, it protects. Quoth's cloak of shadows does the same, but more. Kostya was nodding along in understanding and Buzz pushed on quickly, eager to leave this particular subject behind. Think of failure yourself. The boy grinned. He seemed to have no trouble doing that. A woman can be a thing of beauty, Buzz said slowly. She can be a focus of desire. Felirin is dead, like the knife, the most beautiful. The focus of the most desire for everyone. Buzz let his statement trail off gently yet again. Kostya's eyes were far away, obviously giving the matter his full deliberation. Buzz gave him time for it. And after a moment, another question bubbled out of the boy. Couldn't it be merely glamour? He asked. I said, Buzz, smiling. But what is the difference between being beautiful and seeming beautiful? Well, Kostya stalled for a moment and realized one is real and the other isn't. He sounded certain, but it wasn't reflected in his expression. One would be fake. You could tell the difference, couldn't you? Buzz let the question sail by. It was close, but not quite. What's the difference between a shirt that looks white and a shirt that is white? He countered. A woman isn't the same as a shirt, Kostya said with vast disdain. You'd know if you touched her, if she looked all soft and rosy like Amberlee, or her hair felt like a horse's tail. You know it wasn't real. Glamour isn't just for fooling eyes, Buzz said. It's for everything. Fairy gold feels heavy, and a glamoured pig would smell like roses when you kissed it. Kostril reeled visibly at that. The shift from Amberlee to a glamoured pig obviously left him feeling more than slightly appalled. Buzz waited a moment for him to recover. Wouldn't it be harder to glamour a pig? He asked at last. You're clever, Buzz said encouragingly. You're exactly right. And glamouring a pretty girl to be more pretty wouldn't be much work at all. It's like putting icing on a cake. Kostya rubbed his cheek thoughtfully. Can you use glamour and grammar at the same time? Buzz was more genuinely impressed this time. That's what I've heard. Kostya nodded to himself. That's what Felirium must do, he said. Like cream on icing on cake. I think so, Buzz said. The one I met. He stopped abruptly, his mouth snapped shut. You met one of the fae, was grinned like a bear trap, yes. This time Kosu felt the hook and line both. But it was too late. You bastard, I am, Buzz admitted happily. You tricked me into asking that. I did, Buzz said. It was a question related to this subject, and I answered it fully and without equivocation. Khosrow got to his feet and stormed off, only to come back a moment later. Give me my penny, he demanded. Buzz reached into his pocket and pulled out a copper penny. Does Amberly take her bath? Khosrow glowered furiously, then said, out past Oldstone Bridge, up toward the hills about half a mile. There's a little hollow with an elm tree. And when, after lunch on the Bogan farm, after she finishes the washing up and hangs the laundry, Buzz tossed him the penny, still grinning like mad. I hope your dick falls off, the boy said venomously before stomping back down the hill. Buzz couldn't help but laugh. He tried to do it quietly to spare the boy's feelings, but didn't meet with much success. Kostrel turned at the bottom of the hill and shooted, and you still hold me a book. Buzz stopped laughing then as something jerked loose in his memory. He panicked for a moment when he realized Salem Tincture wasn't in its usual spot. Then he remembered leaving the book in the tree on top of the bluff and relaxed. Relaxed. The clear sky showed no sign of rain. It was safe enough. Besides, it was nearly noon, perhaps a little past. So he turned and hurried down the hill, not wanting to be late. But sprinted most of the way to the little dell, and by the time he arrived, he was sweating like a hard-run horse. His shirt stuck to him unpleasantly, so as he walked down the sloping bank to the water, he pulled it off and used it to mop the sweat from his face. A long, flat jut of stone pushed out into little creek there, forming one side of a calm pool where the stream turned back on itself. A stand of willow trees overhung the water, making it private and shady. The shoreline was overgrown with thick bushes, and the water was smooth and calm and clear. Bare-chested, Buzz walked out onto the rough jut of stone. Dressed, his face and hands made him look rather lean, but shirtless, his wide shoulders were surprising, more what you might expect to see on a field hand, rather than a shiftless sword that did little more than lounge around an empty inn all day. Once he was out of the shadow of the willows, Buzz knelt to dunk his shirt in the pool. Then he wrung it over his head, shivering a bit at the chill of it. He rubbed his chest and arms briskly. Okay, yazın oluyor sanırım şu an olan olaylar. Bu açıdan sonbaharda olduğumuzu biliyoruz. Rüzgarın adından önce desek oluyor. Net bir şekilde bence. Okay. He rubbed his chest and arms briskly, shaking drops of water from his face. He set the shirt aside, grabbed the lip of stone at the edge of the pool, and took a deep breath and dunked his head. The motion made the muscles across his back and shoulders flex. A moment later, he pulled his head out, gasping slightly and shaking water from his hair. Buzz stood then, slicking back his hair with both hands. Water streamed down his chest, making runnels in the dark hair, trailing down across the flat plain of his stomach. He shook himself off a bit, then stepped over to dark niche made by a jagged shelf of overhanging rock. He felt around for a moment before pulling out a knob of butter-colored soap. He knelt at the edge of the water again, dunking his shirt several times, then scrubbing it with the soup. It took a while, as he had no washing board, and he obviously didn't want to chafe his shirt against the rough stones. He soaped and rinsed the shirt several times, wringing it out with his hands, making the muscles in his arms and shoulders tense and twine. He did a true job, though by the time he was finished, he was completely soaked and spattered with leather. Latır, leather, deri olan leather'dan nasıl farklı okuyacağız bilmiyorum. Bast spread his shirt out on a sunny stone to dry. He started to undo his pants, then stopped and tipped his head on one side, trying to jerk loose water from his ear. It might be because of the water in his ear that Bast didn't hear the excited twittering coming from the bushes that grew along the shore, a sound that could conceivably be sparrows chattering among the branches, a flock of sparrows, several flocks, perhaps. And if Bast didn't see the bushes moving either, or not that in among the hanging foliage of the willow branches there were colors normally not found in trees, sometimes a pale pink, sometimes blushing red, sometimes an ill-considered yellow or a cornflower blue. And while it's true that dresses might come in those colors, well, so did birds, finches and jays, and besides, it was fairly common knowledge among the young women of the town that the dark young man who worked at the inn was woefully nearsighted. The sparrows twittered in the bushes as Bast worked at the drawstring of his pants again. Donald apparently giving him some trouble, he fumbled with it for a while, then grew frustrated and gave a great cat-like stretch, arms arcing over his head, his body bending like a ball. Finally, he managed to work the knot loose and shuck free of his pants. He wore nothing underneath. He tossed them aside, and from the willow came a squawk of the sort that could have come from a larger bird. A heron, perhaps, or a crow. And if a branch shook violently at the same time, well, perhaps a bird had leaned too far from its branch and nearly fell. It certainly stood to reason that some birds were more clumsy than others. And besides, at the time Bas was looking the other way. Tam olarak olan olay en başta, o kadına da seks yaptı sanırım, onu açık açık ifade etmedi ama o kadınla görüştükten sonra aşırı terli olduğunu falan söyledi. Yüksek ihtimal yaptılar diyoruz. Aynı olay taraflar yer değiştirmiş bir şekilde bir kere daha tekrarlanıyor gibi. Hani cinsiyetler yer değiştirmiş gibi desek oluyor sanırım. Okay. Bast dove into the water then, splashing like a boy and gasping at the cold. After a few minutes, he moved to a shallower portion of the pool where the water rose to barely reach his narrow waist. Biraz daha yukarı bir yere çıksa bunun penisini görecekler falan. Öyle mi diyorsunuz kanka diyoruz. Not sure. Beneath the water, a careful observer might note the young man's legs looked somewhat odd. But it was shady there, and everyone knows that water bends light strangely, making things look other than they are. And besides, birds are not the most careful of observers, especially when their attention is focused elsewhere. An hour or so later, slightly damp and smelling of sweet honeysuckle soup, Bas climbed the bluff where he was fairly certain that he'd left his master's book. It was the third bluff he'd climbed in the last half hour. When he reached the top, Buzz relaxed at the side of a hawthorn tree. Walking closer, he saw it was the right tree, the nook right where he remembered. But the book was gone. A quick circle of the tree showed that it hadn't fallen to the ground. Then the wind stirred and Bast saw something white. He felt a sudden chill, feeling it was a page torn free from the book. 15 angered his master like a mistreated book. But no, reaching up, Bast didn't feel paper. It was a smooth stretch of birch bark. He pulled it down and saw the letters crudely scratched into the side. Anetta talked to you is important, Reich. Afternoon birds and bees. Gayrı bölüm bitti. Akşam oldu. Hava aydınlıktı, hatırlıyorsunuz mu bilmiyorum. Burayı okumaya başlamışken. Okey diyoruz. Kapatmadan önce diyecek bir şey var mı düşünüp geliyorum. Nope. Hadi görüşürüz.